Hello, Gene Schwimmer here. Welcome to another exciting pulse-pounding episode of In Case You Missed It. And what I do here is I look at one or two news events that happened during the day that you may have missed because you're busy during your day. And I also offer comments. And the news stories are In Case You Missed It. And the comments are a special, extra, great, wonderful, fantastic, free-of-charge bonus. And I also offer advice sometimes. So if you're a world leader, you're going to want to subscribe to these videos, or even if you're not a world leader, just to get the benefit of my wisdom. So today we go to the Supreme Court and we look at two decisions that the court made today. And the first one is the Trump, they call it the travel ban. It's not a travel ban. It's a temporary suspension. And the Supreme Court upheld most of the travel ban. And actually, that's not quite accurate. They're going to hear the complete case in October. What the Supreme Court did today was they vacated the injunctions of the lower court that had prevented the president from barring the entry of any aliens to the United States on security grounds. And now the injunction is lifted except for those aliens who have a close relationship with an American citizen, such as a mother-in-law, brother, sister, family member. That will be heard in October, and hopefully, from my point of view, that part of the injunction will be reversed also, and the president will be able to do what he's clearly allowed to do. I'll just quote the relevant code section, which is 8 U.S. Code Section 1182F, and I'm going to link to it too in case you want to read it. It's very simple. Whenever the president finds that the entry of any aliens or of any class of aliens into the United States would be detrimental to the interests of the United States, he may, by proclamation and for such period as he shall deem necessary, suspend the entry of all aliens or any class of aliens as immigrants or non-immigrants, or impose on the entry of aliens any restrictions he may deem to be appropriate. And what this all boils down to is that the law makes no distinction between an alien who has no relationship whatsoever to somebody in the United States, a citizen or a resident alien, and somebody who is closely related, a brother, a sister, mother-in-law, or a visiting professor, any nature whatsoever. So it's unfortunate that the Supreme Court did not go all the way, and actually three of the conservative justices wanted the injunction vacated in its entirety, but six of the justices would not go along, including, of course, our friends, the four liberals that will always vote together on any issue, no matter what it is. So we'll see what happens. But what's interesting is that in the National Review, we'll link to both articles. You have one writer, David French, saying that this is a great victory for the president because it upholds almost everything that he wants to do. And then you have Andrew McCarthy saying that it's not much of a victory at all because it doesn't go all the way, because you now could possibly have all kinds of cases brought and they could go to the same court that they cherry-picked the first time to get the initial ruling to argue on an individual basis that somebody that Trump wants to ban from coming into the country, that this person is closely enough related that they should be allowed to enter. And so you're going to have a big mess in the courts. But keep in mind that the decision has not been made yet. The case is going to be heard in October, so we'll see how that turns out. And McCarthy's worry is that you have four liberal justices who could be just like the justices in Hawaii and on the Ninth Circuit, that because they have something against Trump, and we have Ginsburg on record as making detrimental comments about Trump, which to me would say that she should recuse herself from hearing the case at all. But McCarthy's concern is that the Supreme Court, when they hear the case, that these justices will be prejudiced against Trump, just as these other lower court justices were, judges were, and that they could rule adversely, and then it's going to boil down to what it so often does, which is Justice Kennedy, the so-called swing vote, in which way he's going to go. So we're still going to have to be in suspense on that issue. And finally, we get to a case that I've been wanting to comment on for a while, which is a so-called gay wedding cake case or cases. There have been a few of these, but none has reached the Supreme Court until now. And finally, we're going to get a definitive answer on it. And I just want to put in my two cents. And it's something that, talking about in case you missed it, this is something that everybody seems to have missed except me. So here's my take on it. The whole issue is whether refusing to bake a gay wedding cake for a gay wedding constitutes discrimination, and whether you can refuse on religious grounds. My take is even on secular grounds, you can refuse to bake a gay wedding cake if you don't discriminate. And this is the part that people seem to miss. Now, does anybody remember James McGreevy? He was the governor of New Jersey, and he was married to a woman. They had two children, and then he came out as gay. And to my recollection, when he got married, I assume they had a wedding cake, and I've never heard of anybody refusing to bake a wedding cake for James McGreevy just because he is gay. And there have been a lot of cases, and there are today, of homosexuals marrying people of the opposite sex. And to my knowledge, no bakery has ever refused to bake a cake for a gay person, or even a gay man and a gay woman choosing to get married for their wedding. And so I don't see the discrimination here. If you refuse to bake a so-called heterosexual wedding cake for a gay couple, but you do for a heterosexual couple, then that's discrimination. Conversely, if you refuse to bake a same-sex or gay wedding cake for a heterosexual couple, and by the same token, if you refuse to bake a so-called gay wedding cake, a same-sex wedding cake for a homosexual couple, it's not discrimination if you also refuse to bake a gay wedding cake, a same-sex wedding cake for a heterosexual couple. Now, you could argue, when is a heterosexual couple ever going to want a same-sex wedding cake? Well, maybe for a friend, to order a wedding cake for a friend. But that's really not the issue. We all have freedom of the press. And just because I am never going to start a newspaper, that doesn't obviate the right. And there's your answer right there. There is no discrimination. As long as they treat everybody the same, as long as they bake a heterosexual wedding cake for everybody, regardless of their sexual orientation, and refuse to bake a gay wedding cake for a couple, regardless of their sexual orientation, there is no discrimination. And I am really surprised that nobody has made this argument. So I have. And that's it for today. Thanks for stopping by. I'm going to sign off now, just mentioning that if you enjoyed this video, I would really appreciate it if you would share the video with your friends and subscribe, so you will never miss a video and never have to bear the shame of somebody telling you about one of my videos in case you missed it, because you won't have missed it. Bye.
You got plan, darling?
I always got plan. They don't ever work, but I always got one.